Once you get a routine, right, and everything goes well, one thing that f***s up, and now you lose it.
Flex Lewis, you're straight out the lair. On this episode, we go off the rails. The first half of the show sees two of the best bodybuilders in the world sit down head to head. And we hear first on who has their sights set on winning that Sandow Trophy. The incredible Derek Lunsford stuck around from his previous episode with us to talk about training, nutrition, and competition. And you can hear and find his episode from previous weeks ago in the description below. My other guest is back by popular demand, and after the most viewed episode of 2022, we pick up where we left off and we talk about his performance and the Mr. Olympia and what is to be expected in 2023. The backstage of competitions, preps, relationships, internal struggles, he reveals all and his exciting new big project. Here's the episode everybody's been asking for, the return of the mutant, Nick Walker. What is going on, guys? First of all, it's a pleasure to see you both. Obviously, Nick, I see you quite frequently.
Almost daily.
Yeah. Nick is a... you're one of the paint in the wall now, the Dragon's Lair. Yeah. I don't know if that's a plug. Is that a compliment? I don't know.
I'll take it, though.
Did Either you way. Say you're painting him on the wall at the Dragon's Lair?
Actually, that's another conversation for another time. But Nick and his team, they have to go through fucking licenses. And it's such a fucking drama. Anyways, Derek, thanks for bringing that up, by the way. you guys got to see each other not so long ago.
Yeah.
Obviously, me being in your shoes as of a couple of years ago, I remember what it was like backstage looking at your competitor. What was it like to see one another off-season? Because you guys don't see each other, you know, often, I'm guessing, right? It's probably at an expo. He's wearing a tank top. You're wearing a tank top. But now you're guest pose. Guest pose in one, next to another.
This year, I mean, he's been in Vegas the whole time. Last year, at this time in the off-season, you know, we would see each other in the gym.
We trained together sometimes.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
I lived in Tampa.
Yeah.
So we would train together. And on occasion, I know he was training with Kamal most of the time. And I feel like we got together more outside the gym than we did in the gym.
Yeah, we hung out a lot.
Yeah.
We did hang out a lot. Yeah.
I didn't know that you had that relationship.
Yeah. We went to the movies together. We double dated Cheesecake Factory, things like that. Yeah.
Really? Yep. This is a fucking horrible start to my podcast, by the way. You're not supposed to be telling me that you went on double dates and stuff.
Well, at that time, I was still like...
Oh, that time you liked each other.
I was still competing in the 212.
Yeah, at that time, you didn't know if he was doing the open yet. I knew this motherfucker was like he doing the open.
I remember you saying that. Yeah, you were saying this guy.
Well, because I'm watching this guy. He's like 255. He's like shoveling cheesecake. I'm like, there's no way this motherfucker's making 212 this year.
No way.
Like, I walked in. He's like, bro, you're going open. I go, no, I swear to you, bro. Like, my sights are set on defending the 212 title. He's like, I don't know, man. I don't know.
Every day before he finally came, I'd look at Maria and be like, he ain't making 212.
I was with Nick. I was looking at this guy. It was like, eh.
And then he did, then he did the guest posing last year in Pittsburgh. Like, he ain't doing no 212. This is ridiculous.
When was it for you that you said, there's no way I'm going to make this 212?
You know what? My crazy mindset, I don't know if it goes back to my wrestling days, but even after the Pittsburgh Pro, bro, like, I was still believing I was going to do the 212 Olympia.
What was like the final?
The thing is, you asked me like my mindset, when did it switch to where there's no way I'm going to make it.
Yeah.
There was never a time where I was like, I can't make the 212 weight. Well, it was just the fact that like I wanted to be, I didn't want to have a weight cap because I knew I could be a better bodybuilder. I could present a better physique if I had more weight to my body, right? If I didn't have that limitation. So me, I wanted to present my best on stage. That's literally all I thought about, win, lose, or draw. And I didn't, going into the Olympia last year in the open for the first time, I didn't know exactly where I would stack up. I had a good idea where I wanted to be, but I didn't know where I would be. But now, you know, I know where we kind of all
started. So you felt like the 212 was kind of hindering you from your true potential.
Exactly. I mean, I think in 2021 is when I brought my absolute hands down best package to the 212 stage, but there wasn't going to be a ton of progress that I could make within that 212 weight cap. So I knew if I had an unlimited amount of weight, then I could be whatever, like 230, 235, whatever, 240, whatever it's going to be.
No.
I could be my ultimate best. And like I said, we talked about it, you know, on and off camera yesterday about, like, that's what takes the pressure away from me. It was just like, I just want to know that by the end of my bodybuilding career, like, I was able to present my absolute best on stage and I didn't hold back.
When did you realize that you weren't going to make the 212, Nick?
When I never did the 212.
Have you ever been 212?
I think when I did my first national show, I was like 198. And that was...
Really?
Yeah, I never went back.
Do you have them photos? I'd love to see what you looked like at 198.
I'll get them to you. Yeah.
You have what was your physique like?
I was actually more aesthetic. I had a very tight, small waist. Mm. It was actually one of my favorite looks because I felt like... If I was able to maintain that type of look and then grow off that, I feel that would have been a better look for me. But I also like the way I look now. It is the freak factor look, and I think it has gotten me to where I am today. It was a very good, appealing look, I think.
Well, I think we can all agree in this room. What you've done with your physique in the last 3 years has been tremendous. You were talking about aesthetics. You know, I think you've read the comments where people were saying, he's not going to bring his waist in, he's not going to do this. Fuck me. Not only did you bring your waist in, you were hitting vacuums. There's so many different things. Now you can do a front double bicep with your abs clenched.
Yeah.
And then you can do it for, you know, full diaphragm of air. And I've seen, because this is the gym, obviously, the posing room has them unforgiving lights.
Fantastic.
And when you're in that room, I know what I look like in there. And when you're consistent, and well, the lights are consistent in there, to see him from the first day he came here to then now go through the Olympia prep to be back in the off season and seeing these improvements, it's exciting, you know. And now to see both of you guys made these improvements, obviously with Derek having that 212 cap popped, which something I never was able to see. So obviously, as an athlete who has lived that same lifestyle, now I can live through you in a sense as a 212 guy. And for yourself now, who has been known as one of the freakiest bodybuilders, the mutant on stage, you've looked at yourself, and without making yourself look freakier, you've decided, okay, I've got to change my training around, I've got to change my nutrition around maybe. But what was that? What was the main thing that you made that has changed these incredible... I mean, listen, your whole physique has changed and the poses that you are doing has changed. What is it?
A lot. Honestly, I think I play a lot of the role to just paying attention to gut health, you know, and that's where I was able to, I think, bring my waist in more than ever. Was I just... First of all, we didn't overeat anymore. Like we didn't go, even though my weight can kind of just flourish.
You were just talking about that earlier.
My
literally,
weight,
literally 10 minutes.
We didn't pound and pound food, but I also made sure I ate food that digested the best. And also, you know, I take a lot of digestive enzymes. I take a lot of, you know, things that just let everything process through.
Explain. No,
but also some people may agree, disagree. One factor that I think played a role for me in particular was I did lower my protein intake a little bit. Mm. And I think, you know, for me, too much protein was giving me more of that bloaty feel. Mm. And I didn't lower it drastically, like maybe like an ounce or so. But that ounce of every meal added up over time. It makes a difference.
That's a meal, really. If in 7 meals a day, you kept in 7 ounces out. That's a meal.
So I think that played a role. I did practice vacuums daily, and which I still do now. And I honestly, you know, I stopped training certain movements that I thought was too much, like, pressure on the waist. Like, I don't deadlift anymore. I'll do RDLs here and there, but nothing crazy, heavy. I don't deadlift. I don't do, you know, free weight squats. I even don't like to do Smith squats that much. I'd rather just do a hack because I just feel like that brings a lot of the pressure, which in my opinion, can bring out the waist a little more. And once I stopped doing that, and
so just, what are you doing now? You're doing more like sissy squats. So, oh, here we go. Here we go. Hey, I didn't. I'm just asking a question here.
I like sissy squats.
That's what it sounded like to me. I didn't know what he was trying to say.
I'm neutral. I'm Switzerland. I'm neutral. I'm Switzerland. Yeah. Daddy, keep talking shit. No. But no. Obviously, the changes have been very. I wouldn't say fast, but
I know for me. Genetically, I grow fast. I can grow very fast. Like, this is probably one of my shortest all seasons I ever had. And I'm 290 and leaner than I was at 305 last off season when I had a year off. This has been very short, but I feel with the changes I made in the training, how I paid attention to recovery more, the gut health, I progressed more in this, I don't know, 3-4 months that I had off first. The whole 10-11 months I had off last year.
Do you think it's also environmental?
Yes. I think environment's everything. And we talked about that in the last podcast. When you are surrounded by, you know, people you actually enjoy being around, you know, you enjoy going to this place, you enjoy going, your life changes. You become happier. You don't have the stress on you. You're living life. And when the things like that happen, your body follows. And I feel like the mind, as I think we talked on this last podcast, the mind's everything.
It is.
If your mind's over here, you're not going to progress over there. You know what I mean? And coming here, you know, like I said on the last podcast, coming here, my body just already got in a good groove. And that's honestly why I didn't want to go back, because I wasn't in a groove there. So I'm like, why would I gonna go? Why, what would I go back for? Did I expect to move? No, not at the moment. But I'm like, I'm going to stay here and finish the prep. That was like kind of the main goal.
Yeah.
And then it just so happens, you know, we moved.
Well, but, Nick, you're such a liar, because you came here and you were like, I'm going to do the podcast. And then literally on the podcast, like, I think I'm going to move here. I go, oh, cool, just for prep? Yeah, I'm looking at renting a house, 12-month lease. I was like.
And I did. I did do that. Well, first, like, we got a little Airbnb place for, like, the rest of prep, pretty much. And then it was, like, 3 weeks later. I'm just, like, really enjoying it. You know, I'm asking Maria, I'm like, how do you, you know, you're having fun here? Like, do you like it here? It was cold, too. And I loved it. Yeah, I love the cold, but I hate snow. So I was thriving.
You were loving it. Shots in a hoodie.
Yeah, right? So then she was like, yeah. And I was just like, let's find something. And then 3 or 4 days later, it's what happened.
I have to say, though, I really enjoy seeing your relationship with Maria. You guys are a great team. She's got your back to no end.
And she does.
Every time I see her in the gym, you know, we always have, I always check in on my boy Nick through her eyes.
I know you do.
And I love the fact that you are very committed to this, you know, this. Not the relationship aside. I know you're committed to the relationship. Jesus, that's going down the road then. No, I wasn't.
What are you
trying
to say here, Flex?
Maria's watching this. Committed? No, I'm committed to the path of chasing the title, just as you are.
Yeah.
You know, obviously I get to see Nick, you know, sometimes daily, then I see you bi-weekly, right? Whether I'm traveling, you're traveling, but you are so focused that even last week I was like, hey, get out the house.
I know.
You know, because I want my friends to know that you can still be the best. Because I can relate to both you guys. I was so focused, so zoned in, that I had to have somebody from, you know, from a different set of eyes. And I was like, listen, go to the movies. Go do this. Go and do that. Because being focused can be detrimental. You got to have balance.
I agree. And I think it can have a negative impact.
No question.
Even on your physique. And I think last year, even when I came down here, I had Maria, I had a good environment, but I also had a little bit of a life. Like, me and Maria, any all on off days, you know, until I was like 2 weeks out and tired and didn't want to move.
Yeah, you're doing a lot.
But
yeah.
I fucking moved. Like, I'm buying furniture, I bought a house, I bought a truck. I did things that I never thought I would do close to a show in my entire life.
Do you think it helped, Nick?
I do. I because as focused as I am, you know, I, like we just said, I think, you know, for me, I get too focused that it becomes a negative thing. And doing, you know, things that were keeping me somewhat sidetracked, it allowed me to perform better.
I agree.
So I think last year, honestly, with the way, you know, and I think we talked about this on the last podcast, with the way my off season went, the way even the starter prep went last year, I would have been happy if I got fifth again. That was like, with the way my mind was at the time and everything was going, I'm like, if I can just get fifth again, it's a win for me after the year I just had. So getting third, in all honesty, was almost as good as winning for me, because I moved up, you know, two spots with a year that I felt I made zero progression, in my opinion. So, you know, and then after me and Matt got back together, that was a nice, like, stress relief for me. It was like, okay.
Yeah.
You know, I knew it was going to take a while for me and Matt to kind of have that relationship again, you know. But now that each week, things just got better and better and better. Me and Maria were just growing stronger and stronger and stronger. I was just progressing like nobody's business weekly. And it was crazy. Even Matt at the time, he was like, your body's changing pretty rapidly.
Yeah, Matt's hit me up a few times. He's like, what is he doing over there?
I know.
My gosh.
And I was enjoying life. Mm-hmm. And I think that was the problem is, before, I wasn't happy. I wasn't enjoying anything. I didn't even enjoy prep for the time being, because I didn't feel, you know, I was going to perform. And people kind of already counted me out in the beginning of that prep, you know, because me and Matt split, and then everything else was happening. So I just fell into that believing it. And then once I got here, things started to progress. My confidence came back. Me and Matt were on a roll. And I'm like, fuck this. I'm going to win this motherfucker. You know? And that's, you know, I didn't win, obviously. But to go from fifth to third as, you know, my second Olympia, it was, especially, like I said, after the year I had, it was that's a win for me. You know, and now that I had, like I said, not a long off season, but even doing after the Olympias and the Arnolds, everything kind of just stayed the same. You know, it was just, we're living life, we're progressing, we're having fun. I traveled more than I ever thought I would travel in my entire life. I finally got a passport, so people can leave me the fuck alone about that now.
You never had a passport?
No, not until, that was part of the, like, my HD thing. I had to get a passport.
Have you never been out of the country except Canada?
No.
Never?
No. Oh, listen, we got to get that. Hey.
Yeah.
I'm going to get some places.
You're going to be traveling a lot next year.
I know.
I'm going to get some places linked.
And I'll be honest. I'll say it loud and clear. I hate traveling because it's nerve-wracking as a competitor.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the food, I worry about how am I going to eat, worrying about packing this, worrying about packing that. Like, when I was younger and didn't give a shit, I'd be like, no big deal. But now there's so much, and it's like, once I get to where I'm traveling and I'm chill, I'm happy, I'm cool, yeah. Everything went to plan. But it's the process of getting everything together, making sure I don't lose my luggage doing this. I make sure I have that. How am I going to get, you know, this thing? Do they got food ready for me over there? Where am I going to pack a bunch of? It's a million questions. And then you start to, you know, stir yourself up. And I got Maria going, calm the fuck down.
Yeah, I can certainly help you with some, mental checks as well. Some, you know, whenever you're going anywhere. Traveling for us guys, because you don't want to miss a beat. You don't want to leave anything at home. You're surrounded with your creature comforts. You got everything that's tangible. But when you jump on that plane and you say you head to the UK, Derek's been to the UK a number of times right now. Yeah. Have you ever missed a beat in the UK?
No, man. I mean, I think if I can relate to Nick, it is stressful, man.
Yeah,
it is.
I'm sure your Germany one was pretty stressful.
Oh, bro.
Let me tell you something.
Well, incredible show.
I didn't mean to cut you off, but when I was like watching your stories, Trevor's, I looked at Marie and said, this is my nightmare.
Bro, he lost
this is my biggest nightmare.
He lost his camera bag.
Your guy?
Yeah. Oh. So me, my wife, and Trevor, right? We all get to Germany, and I was supposed to have a driver to come pick me up. Well, they never showed. So what did I do? I got on the train. I've done that before by myself, but I had this extra pressure, this stress of having them two with me, and they've never been out of the country like that. So, or at least to Germany. So I'm thinking it's okay. Just like, I'm frustrated about the situation. I'm hungry. I'm tired. And we get there and we get on the train, and we get to where we think we're supposed to stop, and we just quickly jumped off. And like as we're jumping off, Trevor like was about to grab his other bag, and the door shuts.
Oh,
yeah, and that was the most important bag, bro. Like it had over $10,000 worth of stuff: his laptop, SD cards that had content that had never been seen before.
Don't listen to this, Nick. It doesn't happen.
And on and on. But
this is why I don't travel.
Nick, you're traveling. Yeah. Nick, you're traveling.
But dude, that was honestly this past year going to Germany was the most stressful experience I've ever had traveling, but that was kind of like a freak accident. Now we did get the bag back. Everything's good. Everything was there. Everything except his beef sticks, he said. So
his beef sticks.
Well, the guy that brought it back probably said, this is my tip.
Yeah, I'm going to take these American beef sticks.
Right. Exactly. But no, it was super stressful. The event was great, right? And everything was great.
People was wild.
But, you know, typically, if you're working with a promoter, they generally are very hospitable and make sure that you have everything that you need ahead of time. They're like, okay, are you going to train here? So they figure out a gym or do you need meals? Okay, we'll make sure, like, send me your meal plan. Like, I'll just have the meals ready for you. And in the event that it doesn't happen, then generally you can try to, you know.
There's somebody's going to help
make
you.
Make plans in advance. But there's generally everybody. The thing is about bodybuilding in this community, it is close-knit.
Everyone normally looks out for one another. Yeah.
Especially if you're going to their country, they want to make sure that they leave the best
impression. You feel welcomed. Yeah. You make sure you come back.
So shout out to everyone that helped me in Germany this year, because I had a handful of guys who came to the rescue for us. And so, yeah, I mean, it's just really cool. Like when you experience something like that, that people come together to help you. Mm. And then when people come to my town, I want the same thing. I want to be there for them.
With the sight of traveling, I wanted to just add that if you end up going to, you know, the UK, for example, I think if, I don't know if Body Power is still on, because I haven't heard much of Body Power, but I know it's going to be another expo. But that was a big expo where, you know, myself and Derek would see each other once a year, and then it would be feeble. But it was great to go on the road and see so many of the guys from the US that you don't get to see, but just in another country. Yep. So this camaraderie, this brotherhood happens. You know, if he's going through shit, then you're going through shit. Yeah. You know, if you're stuck somewhere, well, guess what? You're stuck somewhere too. But I also think the fact that you're in another country, you're experiencing new things, different foods, different cultural things. That's something that you need to do. So I'm glad you got your passport, because now I know that.
No, I am actually excited to travel more, because once, like I said, once I do it,
yes,
I'm having fun.
But there's a method to it too.
You know, like
you've got to practice. And and if your bag gets lost, guess what? You can buy it. That's what you have to have the mindset of.
You're right. Yeah. But like when I did the Canada tour, you know, when we flew on the private jet, like that shit was fun.
Private jet.
Yeah, but that's we're talking about private jet over here, bro.
I know.
That doesn't happen for everyone.
Let me explain. And this isn't me being ungrateful.
This is how much he gets paid in HC, bro.
No, wow.
Dorian,
listen,
hit your boy up.
Listen, that plane was so fucking small. I had to sit all the way at the front. I got stuck.
Because you're the mutant, bro. You need a 747 for this guy.
Hold on. And this motherfucker, this plane, I felt every little bit of turbulence.
Yeah.
I almost wanted to throw up. Yeah. Like, I'm afraid of heights as is. Mm. I don't like flying. And on this part, you felt everything. And I'm like, oh, my God. And then I got the guy who owns it. He's like, oh, the last time a plane crashed was like 1970-something. I think you're fine. I'm like, oh, did you tell me that?
I'd be like, oh, I think we're due now. Yeah.
I'm like, why? We're in the air, bro.
But how was the Canadian tour?
No, it was fun, man. I really enjoyed meeting everyone.
Yeah.
Everyone there was awesome. Everyone that worked at the, you know, the supplement world was awesome. The people were awesome. Everyone that came out. It was an awesome time. Like I said, once I'm there, I'm doing it, I'm having a blast. Yeah. I love it. So I definitely want to start traveling more to meet, you know, everyone from all over the world. I see why people do it, and I think I just overall think it's fun.
Is there anywhere like that you are interested in going? Like for bodybuilding or just for yourself?
Italy.
Yeah, that place
would be beautiful, bro.
I do want to go to Italy.
See if you sing with Yamamoto, but anyway, that's another subject.
Okay. No, but you just talk about how much he made at HD. See?
I try. That's true. You know, there's no private jets at the Yamamoto, but, you know. But either way, at least the planes they put me on, you don't feel turbulence. No, Italy is a beautiful place. You've got to do it. It's like a bucket list place. Have you been to Italy?
No, man.
Okay.
Everybody's been going there now.
I'll tell you this. I've been to Rome, I think, 3 times now. It's, if I'm there, I've got to go to the Colosseum.
Of course.
For us who have trained for many different preps, you know, when you're going into a prep, you know, you have these moments where you kind of feel like a warrior. You know, there's days where you're fucking tired
and then you feel
like this workout is going to be, this is going to define, whatever. You know what I mean? You have that talk. Or maybe it's just me. I don't know.
No. But, I'm with you.
But Rome and the Colosseum, there's something there.
Something about it, right?
You should just feel it. Tyus, have you been to Rome? Where's your mic? Tyus. So let me explain also the situation, you guys. I know we're going all over the place, but myself and Nick, we're going to do podcast part 2 today. And obviously with Derek in town, Derek asked me, could he make an improv
I want to crash halfway through, but then I was already in here.
Yeah, improv.
So that one just looks like you're part of it.
And yeah. I said, Derek, just jump on, grab a mic. And Nick was just, oh, fuck no, I don't want this guy on the
podcast. This is my fucking podcast.
This is my podcast.
Well, I do got to watch it time.
You had yours yesterday.
Yeah. No, but if you need a jump, just say jump, okay?
I got to figure out what time it is. Trevor just left.
I'll let you know.
Yeah, he's good. Yeah. But yeah, that explains why I have both Derek and Nick in here. Obviously, you know, I want to also say now and direct this attention to the fact that Nick is a 2002 champion of my podcast. Having the most views. Nick, we're going to present you with something today. But unfortunately, he wasn't ready. But we've got an award.
Really?
Yeah. Most viewed podcast in 2022 of my
That's
page.
Exciting.
Yeah. And again, I wish I had something tangible to give you. So okay. The only thing I can give you is the words of that podcast was fucking incredible. Truly enjoyed it. I think, I know a lot of people benefited from that podcast. I most certainly did not expect us to get into the deep waters that we did, and I truly enjoyed it.
I appreciate it. You even having me on, I enjoy doing these things, and I enjoy it more when it's people, you know, who I looked up to in this industry, who I now became good friends with, and I think it makes it more. What's the word I'm looking for? Like organic, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Like it just goes, you know.
So I just wanted to tell you that you changed the entire landscape of what this podcast was about with that episode. Because by the way, I know you guys can't see me, but this is Tyus.
Is the voice of God.
So what you did in that podcast is you gave people something that they could relate to, and that changed every episode we've ever had since then. So I just want you to know what an impact it had.
That's awesome. And that's one thing, you know.
Truth, Nick.
I was always, you know, nervous about telling my, you know, story of, you know, my childhood and things like that, because I was afraid to get made fun of, to be judged of that nature. But then, you know, another part of me was like, oh, if somebody has something to say, like, they're a piece of shit, right? But I wanted to express my story and what I was able to accomplish and overcome to let people know if I can do it, you can do it. You know, it was sure as hell is not easy by any means. It's never going to be easy. And like I said, that your past doesn't define you, but it's always going to be a part of you. And it's your job to determine whether you want to use it for good or bad. And for a while, I used it for bad. I did not the greatest things. And then I seen what it was doing to my family, my friends, people close around me. And I knew for myself I had to make a quick turnaround fast. And, you know, I'm not necessarily a believer, you know, in the whole going to see a therapist and all these things. I think it works. I think it's beneficial. But at the same time, I think if you want to make the change, you want to be that change, you don't need anyone to do it. Like, you can do that on your own. And the people around you, when they see the change, they start to come closer to you. They recognize it without even telling you. You can just feel that people become more welcoming around you, happier. And I noticed that was happening without even anyone saying a word. And that's, you know, that's a message that I like to deliver. It's words aren't everything, right? It's the actions that always determine everything. And, you know, whatever you've done, any mistakes you've made in your life, it's not, the mistakes don't define you. It's what you do after that defines you. How do you fix it? What do you do? And, you know, like I said, I've made plenty of mistakes. And one thing I can truly say is, you know, I've always been a man of my word. And I've always, you know, there was a time I looked my mother in the face and I said, I'm going to make a change. I said, it's not going to be easy. I said, it's not going to be tomorrow. I said, it probably won't even be next week. I said, but the change is going to happen. And I just need everyone to be patient. And it happened, you know, and thankfully, you know, I had Maria come in my life and, you know, she's made life better. We have our ups and downs. It's, you know, we live together. You're not, you know what I mean? It happens.
Couple life.
We are a great team and we understand each other. She understands me more. I understand her more. And having that relationship with her just made life a lot better. Having that great bond with my family now it's changed a lot for me. And I think it's not just made me a better bodybuilder, but it's just made me a better individual.
That episode, and I know obviously it was so close to Olympia when you done that, and you know, taking ourselves back to that time, you and I had this conversation for the viewers who may have seen the podcast, which I'm sure you have. But just for a reminder, Nick was in Florida. There was a lot of changes that were going on. I spoke to Nick. I spoke to Matt. Obviously, you guys know Matt Johnson, myself, are very close. And I said, I want Nick on the podcast because a lot of people are kind of blind to listening to the truth. Mm-hmm. They don't, you know, deaf, I should say. Blind and deaf. In my world, that makes sense. There's a lot of people are deaf to listening to the truth unless it's kind of put in front of them. And with my podcast, I felt a strong calling to bring you on. Now, when we first spoke, you kind of looked for a few excuses not to do it. Oh, they're traveling.
Well, I did it like, I'm 8 weeks out. I don't know, bro.
And thank goodness. Mom, I love you. I love your mom and your dad. Mom said, you've got to do it, Nick, or whatever that context was.
But. Well, no, she wasn't that nice. She pretty much said, get your ass on that plane and go on Flex's podcast.
And thank goodness for Mom, because for me, as we've already said, and Tyus has said, that was a great podcast that changed a lot of people's lives. I mean, the comment section was, I mean, you went from, you know, dead if I say this, but you went from, because of all the circumstances going on, people made their own minds up about you, Nick. They were all talking.
No, I know.
You were the heel. You know, in some cases, and they were using you as the heel against whoever else you were standing against. You know, not that I'm saying the podcast changed that perception, but it did for the viewers who watched it.
It helped give people a better understanding.
And what an understanding. But again, it goes back to the interviewee. You know, it's the one that, as long as that person is open and honest, we had a great podcast yesterday. As long as you're open and honest and you get that story out, and you've done a damn good job about doing it. You left no stone unturned. You truly said what went on, which kind of blew my mind. And I was kind of, I had no note card for that. You know, I was like, oh my God,
fuck these cards.
which again, how I know, you sit in your chair, I sit in mine. I heard so many stories from that.
Awesome.
People that were like, wow, I'm so blown away. Nick is my new favorite bodybuilder. So whatever, changing the variable. What did you hear from your shoes?
The same thing. I got a lot of DMs, you know, people telling me their stories, you know, their childhood and things, you know, that they did to try and help and how much the podcast and seeing someone, you know, quote unquote, they look up to speak of their, you know, past and how they did it. And like I said, it's those things that remind me of, like, why I do what I do, you know? And because I think sometimes we get so wrapped up in our own shit, we forget the purpose sometimes, you know? And then when you get messages like that, or even when people, you know, in a gym just, you know, say, hey, like, I look up to you, can I get that? Those are the things that keep me going sometimes, you know? That stuff never gets old. You know, and then it's like when I did the Canada tour, you know, and I pull up to a store and there's this long fucking line of people. It's like, wow, like these people want to meet me. You know, it's as confident as I come off as, you know, and all that. I'm still very humble And when I see those types of things, it does get me a little emotional, because it's like, I just started to be the best bodybuilder I could be. You know, I didn't ever think I was going to, you know, inspire so many people here. And when you realize that, it does kind of become a little life-changing for you in what you're capable of doing for others.
Well, that video, I think, hit just under 600,000 views. And I truly think that's going to be over 1 million by the end of this year. The way it's still, I mean, I get to see all the back end stuff, and it's still pumping. It, like, had a crazy run, and then it kind of, like, slowly, and then another one. So whatever it is that gets brought up and said is so relevant at any point in time. There's no time stamp on that.
No.
From what you said. It's just the learning of who Nick Walker is. And here we are with part two, the most demanded, I would say, guest. So a full circle. And joined is also with your arch rival. Derek Lunsford.
Dun, dun, dun.
But yeah, we've got you both on the podcast. So where are you? Obviously, we spoke to Derek yesterday, but I still want to make sure that we bring this up to where are you right now in your prep, off-season wise? You started it?
Yeah, we started, 3 weeks ago when I was 20 weeks out. Mm. I like to get started early. I like longer preps. I know Matt likes longer preps. It just... not that we think of, you know, if there's an error, but it allows room for if something was to happen. Like, okay, we got time, let's fix.
I'm a 20-week guy, too.
Yeah, and, you know, I like to come down very, very slow. I like to be able to especially, you know, be ready early, so that way, you know, I'm able to feed into the show, pull back on a lot of things, let the body rest, recover. And that's kind of what we did. Somewhat for the Olympia last year, you know, because like I said, once I got here, the body just was going. That by the last week or so, we were kind of able just to kind of chill. And personally, I didn't think that was going to happen. I figured we were going to be a little behind, but my body, like I said, my body just took off. And right now, Matt's very happy, you know, with the progression that I've made within the short off season that I had. He likes the way I look now. We'll be 16 weeks out this Friday. So he's, as long as he's happy and he's got nothing really bad to say, it lets me know I'm doing good. Food wise, it's, you know, I'm still eating obviously, but he cuts down little by little. Cardio's 25, 30 minutes every day except leg day. Training, I'm kind of doing the, push pull leg type of training.
Interesting.
Which is, I'm doing, the RP strength. Type training. I follow the app that we have. And I've been doing that, honestly, since the Arnold. And I think that's why I've made a lot of progress that I haven't done in a while. I was talking to you about this yesterday a little bit. It's nothing new that I haven't done. It's more so something like I forgot I knew how to do, which is, you know, full range of motion, very slow, pauses in the hole, explode up. And you don't do so many intensifiers, so to speak, like a rest, pause, drive. It's more just sets. More sets every week. You pull back, you restart. And my body, I'm 290. And I like to think this is the leanest I've been at 290, you know.
I would say so.
And the recovery is, you know, the only thing with this training is you have to really pay attention to recovery, because it's a little more frequency, you know?
Okay. So break us down on the split right now, if you don't mind, for the viewers that are listening to this. You're doing a push-pull.
Legs. And then I take off, and then I just repeat.
So one day on, one day off?
No, 3 days on, one day off.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, push-pull legs. I'm sorry. Yes. Bro, I have these acronyms and fucking... words didn't exist when I was competing.
All that blood is still in his chest from that workout.
Yes, that's... I never got a podcast, buddy. Do I? I think it's just the fucking light. Me and myself and Neil, never done any push-pull, never done any of that. Not that we were against it. We just came from the old school cloth, and now where, you know, the 3 days on, one day off, that would probably work better for me right now in my world,
yeah,
because of the businesses and the time that I don't have. But as you know, I'm doing the transformation. So the bodybuilding, you know, 3 days on, 1 day off. I train bodybuilding 3 days, and then I'm doing strength and conditioning.
That's awesome.
On top of that. But what about you, Derek? Off-season training, push-pull legs?
No, but I do think it is important, like, when your recovery is down and, like, and you are still training really hard, I think it is okay to have an extra rest day. So when I'm getting ready for the Olympia, training 6 days in a row, taking the seventh day off, that's the way I like to always do it.
So one day off a week.
One day off a week.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd probably be in the gym every day if I could.
I know.
But I think, like, off-season, it's good if I do, like, let's say 3 days, like what he was doing, like 3 days on, 1 day off. 2 days on, 1 day off.
That's my split.
Yeah, something like that. I think that's, for me, that's solid. I mean, however you structure it, whether it's push-pull legs or a different way, you know, I think just having, you know, three really intense days back to back to back, I think you're going to earn that rest day. And then you come back, do two more hard days, rest again, and then that starts your week over.
I agree.
What I'm very interested to hear from both of you guys, and something I wish I implemented myself was, both of you have had the same conversation with me off camera, and you just kind of made a note to it now. And me and Derek talked about this literally 30 minutes ago. That's why I looked at Derek when you were talking. Decrease in protein, allowing your body to have that digestive rest. I could not come off the gas with food. I would take a day off training because I needed it, because I told myself, I was at that point in my time in life where I was like, okay, I know this is a rest day. It's not because I'm fucking tired and I'm making the excuse to have that rest day. My body is fucketed, as Rafael Brando would say. Fucketed. And I need that day off. So that's why I had 3 days on, 1 day off, 2 days on, 1 day off. My point in saying that, I never had a day off eating. I didn't allow myself to have a day off eating. But now I'm come to find out, and I think this is very good conversation for the viewers, that you two are the best in the world, right? Regardless where you placed, and where you placed this year, and where you placed last year, you are that 0.1% that are at the top of the tree. And yet there you are, you've both said, you take off some days where you don't eat as much. The calorie content, macronutrients, micronutrients are all there, but you put it into three meals, you said earlier, this is on camera too, and you just kind of said the same thing where you decrease your protein so you allow your body to digest and you are focusing on digestive health.
Yep.
Two bodybuilders, the best in the world, have both used that sentence within the last hour, digestive health. And I was searching and I spent a fortune on gut health doctors. Not one of them guys, knowing what I do for a living, told me to decrease my food or eat less.
Really? Yeah.
And I think what you guys are talking about right now for the viewers is very critical. Again, I was never even shown that as an option. In fact, me and Derek were saying, my wife was the first person to say, babe, I think you should eat less. She's a dietitian, nutritionist, so... You know, but I never went to Neil and said, hey, coach, I think we should put stock in this. You know, Neil is very open. He listens to everything. But then I didn't come to him with a complaint saying, I'm not getting my meals down. I told him I was struggling to get my meals down. Not once did he offer to say, hey, stop
that
eating.
That was probably your body telling you to eat less.
Yeah.
Honestly. Listen, as you know, no. I went from 7 meals to eating maybe 4 meals a day. That it didn't fall off fast. I've worked my ass off for this to fall off.
Well, that was the thing. When I lowered the protein, you know, the mindset we all have, I'm like, oh, no, am I going to lose muscle, you know, losing low protein? If anything, I got bigger because everything was digesting properly.
Well, you were probably eating plenty of calories anyway, right?
Yeah.
So when your carbs are up, your fats are up, right, you probably don't really
That's the thing. I found for my body specifically, I work better with a moderate protein intake and a higher carb, higher fat.
What numbers are we looking at for the viewers?
400 protein, probably 8,000, 12,000 calories for this mutant.
And I'll do about like I don't know.
450 grams of protein per day on a low day. What, 15,000 calories?
That's a lot of protein.
I think I got the hot dog post workout from Nick. That's what
I told him that.
Yeah. What the hot dog?
You didn't see the YouTube video?
I said after workout, you got to eat at least a dozen hot dogs.
Yeah.
You know what somebody told me when I first started training?
Yeah.
Go to the fish and chip shop and eat fish and chips and a tub of ice cream.
Are you serious?
You better believe I committed to that. And Tommy said, bro, you've been doing this? I was like, I was joking.
No, you got to
watch that every day.
You got to watch the YouTube video that's on my YouTube channel.
Okay.
Not a plug, just it's a pretty cool one. Like my
see, bro, he plugs all day long. He says, guys, unbelievable.
Here's the thing. Unbelievable. If you got to say it's not a plug, it's a plug.
Bro, no, I'm just saying this
plugs
is actually
so much shit.
This is just like a really cool video. No, because
I'm joking. Check out Derek's video. Let's
I'm telling you, bro, like my buddy. So you've heard of the Nathan's Hot Dog Eating Contest,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely,
yeah. So that just happened on the 4th of July. It's an annual, whatever, it's number one eating competition.
What's that guy who's the champ of that?
Joey Chestnut.
Joey Chestnut.
So my buddy, lives in Tampa, Bartley Weaver, he just competed in that. He's also a classic physique pro.
Wow.
But he's a professional eater. He just placed fifth and ate 41 hot dogs in 10 minutes at the Nathan's Hot Dog Eating Contest. But on our YouTube video, he ate 42.
41?
Yeah, bro.
Nick, that you don't look impressed.
I'm very, that's disgusting.
I don't even really like hot dogs, I'll be honest.
I don't
even. Really? I actually like hot dogs.
Really?
Yeah.
Have you seen what goes into a hot dog?
That's why I really don't eat them. But I do like a hot dog.
I don't eat them, but I do like them.
Yeah.
So you were saying about that video, not spoiling it, but.
I just think it was cool because I like, bro, like you get, I ate 11, if that tells you anything. I ate 11 hot dogs in 10 minutes, and he ate 42, gained 13 and a half pounds in 10 minutes.
Question
for but you. At the same time, he's a classic physique pro, and he can suck in a sick vacuum.
Good for him.
It's wild. But anyway.
Yeah. Good for
him. I've always wanted to know this. These guys who do these hot dog eating contests and fucking this and that contest, do they purge after? They throw up after to get all that out?
He told me that he doesn't like to do stuff like that. He would like to like let it just settle. But if it's going to come up, then why would you force it down? Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? So. Yeah. Sometimes I think it's better to just allow your body to do what it wants to do.
I agree.
So
sounds like one of your cheat days.
Yeah.
Well, so that was like another thing. Like, even though, like, my diet wasn't like pushing food. If me and Maria went out to eat, I fucking ate, bro. Like,
what is your spot? Cheesecake right?
Factory. Yeah, I watched this guy.
We gotta get this guy a fucking sponsorship of the Cheesecake Factory.
I would literally. I wouldn't say gorge food till I felt sick, but I would. I would eat, but I would feel fine. Like, I'd be good. But I would gain, you know, within the next day, 6-7 pounds. But then I'd lose it. All right. And then I would just do it again and lose it all right. And I think me and Matt actually did this, not like that, but when I prepped for New York Pro, we kind of did, like, a very strict diet. And then on my leg day, I'd go out, have a very big breakfast, have like 2 or 3 clean meals, and then have a dinner where I just ate whatever I want, wake up, you know, 5-6 pounds, whatever. And by the time it was time to do it again, I'd be down like 2 pounds from what I was the following week. And it worked. Like, my body, I got lean pretty fast. So I did that after the Arnold, or after the Olympia, before I started prep for the Arnold. I did that even after the Arnold for a few weeks, and then before I got, you know, sick of eating food. But like, I never got fat. I stayed pretty dry, hard, and then, you know, after Matt started to increase calories a little bit, my cheat meals kind of simmered down.
He told me the secret, though. I don't know if I should let it out there, but he said only red velvet cheesecake.
Yeah, red velvet cheesecake only.
Is that the secret?
That's the secret.
You can't have the other ones, just that one.
That's the secret.
I'm not even going there. Nobody needs the sound bites that are coming out of my mouth right now. But anyway, so talking about, not to jump all over the place, but the Cheesecake Factory was always my my place to go to.
It always. Never fails.
Never fails. That's so little context this and kind of unuseful information, but that's where the Flex Lewis signature meal comes from in MegaFit, is the miso salmon. That's my favorite meal at the Cheesecake Factory. So I went to the boys at MegaFit, shout out to PG and Billy and Megan. A megamine. So I told him, I was like, this is what I want. So they took it to the chefs and they made that meal. And I think they knocked it out of the park. That's that is a bit of a shameless plug because it
it's the best. Fire meal.
Oh, thank you, Dan.
It is.
I was
going to
plug
meal.
It then, but you've done it for me.
Yeah. It is. Have you had it? Do you eat it?
I don't eat fish.
At all?
No.
No salmon, no white fish, no nothing?
Chicken or beef, baby.
Ever. Like even, wow.
Have you ever had salmon?
Yeah.
Oh, you've had it, you just don't like it.
I throw up.
What?
I throw right up.
Wow. Just a gag reaction or is it just, or do you think it's already in your head before you even put the fucking.
No, because not last year, but like every prep I would like, I'm going to eat fish. Mm. And I would think of it as a hardcore so thing. Like, I'm a fucking fish. You know, I'm going to get peeled. And every time I would do it, I'm like, oh, fuck your goals.
Yeah.
And I would just throw up. So I'm like, I can't do it. So like majority of my preps, it's literally 99% like ground turkey, fat-free, chicken, or just steak.
Bro, you know what's crazy? I didn't realize until last year, I was eating so much cod.
Oh, it's gross.
Yeah, I don't mind. I don't mind fish. I like fish, I especially salmon. But dude, I ate so much cod last year.
You smelled like that shit.
That I smelled like.
Yeah, you smelled, bro, smelled gross.
You know what I actually smelled like? It smelled like.
You smelled like dick and balls.
Urine. Cat urine?
Like gross. Cat urine. And I was just like, I thought that was maybe like my. That's kind of embarrassing to say, but seriously. I thought
you
it was
know,
just,
their fans are going to go up to Derek and go, yeah, bro, I smell it.
Smell
I smell
like
it.
Cat urine.
No, but we switched it up. We're like, no, we can't be having this. Like, that's too bad. So I backed off one meal of cod and I just, it was perfectly fine. But no, like, I was eating it like all day long and I said, dude, this is not good. I thought it was maybe like my clothes just being sweaty for too long and like, you know, how you just, you don't wash it fast enough or something like that.
That's
and then
my,
been there. And then, but. No, this was like,
this was fish.
It was a raunchy sweat smell.
You guys ever had tilapia?
Yeah.
Even worse.
Gross.
Yeah.
Even worse.
It's
so
disgusting.
That would come through my pores.
Oh my God.
And cardio, you know, that I'd come back from cardio soaked. Then I would train. Yeah. Then I would do another set of cardio. So back, I was single. I was washing the shit out of my clothes. I was like, I'm going to wear this shirt. I'm going to double up on this shirt. To the point in the end, I was like, I gotta throw this shirt. This is not even coming out in the wash now. And by the way, I'm sitting like this. Don't give me shit. He was like,
"It's cute."
I sat like this yesterday. He was like, "I see your stance. You look. You're sitting like this on Bradley Martin's podcast." The reason why I'm sitting like this is I've got a big hole in my fucking jeans that I don't want to fucking show you, but I will now. So.
Right where his birdie is.
Right.
I put it on for Nick. I thought it was just gonna be a Nick show today, but nonetheless, are you good on time? You going to time?
Yeah, I'm
going
to have to skip out here in just a minute.
Okay.
I'll let you guys do the rest
125.
Of this. Yeah, let me, I think this is my time.
Well, hold on. Before you shoot off.
Okay.
The rivalry is on for this year's Mr. Olympia. Obviously, both of you guys are at pretty much the same age, right?
30, yeah.
20, 28.
I'll be 29 and next month.
And you are the next generation. You are... At the face, I think you made a, I think it was yourself, Derek, that said this, that the Pittsburgh Pro is truly the new gen. I looked at that lineup. Everybody's kind of at the same age. All of you guys are kind of peaking at the exact time. I feel like all of you guys are leveling up at the same time too. Not one of you is ahead of anybody else. We're not talking about Ronnie Coleman and some. Everybody's all... up and up the bar.
As a bodybuilding fan, that's what I love
about
this, is that everybody's young, everybody's hungry, and as exciting as last year's Olympia was...
This one will be better.
This one is 2.0 version. Every single person is improved.
Yeah.
You know, myself, Nick, Samson, I'm sure Hottie, we haven't seen him, but we know he's training hard. Mm-hmm. Everybody is going to be improved this year.
I'll say this too. That Pittsburgh Pro, I've been to Pittsburgh Pro... probably over a decade. That was the best off-season Pittsburgh Pro I have ever seen. You guys put on one hell of a show. I think the standard of that Pittsburgh Pro off-season now was kind of in everybody's head because a lot of people just kind of turned up. You know, RIP with Sean. You know, I think Sean, that year the Sean guest pours, I think there was a lot of, you know, this is an off-season for a bodybuilder. And then... that was the only year that I've ever seen somebody that's come in like that off season. You know what I mean? I don't want to sound disrespectful to Sean, but obviously we're athletes. You gotta be prideful of what you do. You gotta eat to have that, you know, not only you are what you look like, right? So you're representing yourself, your sponsors, XYZ. Yeah. You guys came out there and my gosh, it was a show. And when you guys turned up for that Pittsburgh Pro, and obviously you're backstage and you're looking around, and obviously you guys know who's made improvements or not. You're looking around and saying, look at fucking Nick's fucking legs. And you're probably saying, you know, look at fucking Derek's, I don't know.
Derek, look at his hair. Derek looks small
look
to me.
Look at his hair. He has a nice smile. Small.
But what goes on back there? Because I know for me, when I used to guest pose and stuff, I was a 212 guy. You know, I was very blessed that I was guest posing normally against open class guys. So I was like, okay, yeah, I can hold my own against this guy up there today, you know? Yeah. And I always made sure that I pridefully had a good off-season condition. So that's one of the reasons why I had a lot of appearances.
Yeah.
You guys coming out there this year, what was it like to know, or maybe even not had thought about this, that this now, you're in a moment. This right now for you guys, don't just let this pass. Smell the roses right now. Because both of you guys are going through a moment where equally you both talked about this is your generation. The fans that are following me now are still following me now, but they're now looking at you. But now is a new set of fans that are replaced, and they're looking at you. You are there, guys. You are going to be talked about buying the magazines and seeing you in there. And here you are now battling it out. You know, the names of what will be on the Olympia Trophy, maybe sitting in front of me right now. What was that like to be guest posing against a competition? And also, what was it like then to see the photos and the feedback that came from it? Whoever wants to take the floor.
When I first saw the feedback, I said, man, I'm going to whoop everyone's ass. I said, these motherfuckers right here. I'm like, I'm like,
easy,
yeah, buddy.
Easy.
No. I mean, I did think that, yeah. But.
I love Nick's confidence.
I love it, dude.
No, but honestly, when, you know, seeing everybody, I said, okay, you know, everyone's in shape. Yeah. Everyone is progressing. Everyone is making improvements. Samson made improvements. Derek made improvements. Hunter has definitely made his improvements. So I'm like, okay, you know, I notice everybody is taking it very serious. And you can always tell by the way someone looks.
Mm-hmm.
So when seeing that, I said, okay, you know, this is going to be a very, very good Olympia this year. I said, this isn't going to be easy for anyone. You know, I don't think, in my opinion, I don't think anybody's spot is promised going into this Olympia. And it's going to be a battle, you know? And I think the top five is going to be very epic. I think we're all going to be in shape. I think we're all going to be hard, dry, peeled, all the above. And it's going to be a show for everyone to see.
What do you see yourself placing?
One.
On to Derek.
Well, I can say, you know, I'm a bodybuilding fan, first and foremost. I'm just very proud to be a part of this generation. You know, like I talked to you on and off camera yesterday as well. Like when I came in to this sport, I turned pro, I got to the Olympia, was competing in the 212. I told you backstage before we went on stage, Jose Raymond and David Henry, all the top five guys, I said, I hope to make you guys proud when you guys do retire. And if I'm still competing, God willing, you know, like, I just want to hopefully carry that torch and be a positive role model in the sport. And that's what's so cool is that you have a group of guys doing that. It's not just one or two. Like, I feel like we're all helping elevate this sport together. And I just hope that we can continue to inspire others to want to come along and elevate to the next level. We're not there, right? So that's what I think about. And as far as like being in the moment, that's so important. Like, that's something that you told me too, is like, you and Jose both said, like, just do your best to try to soak it all in as much as you can. It's going to be hard. It's not easy. You're going to be wanting to go from one thing to the next. And you're always looking for the future. You're always trying to accomplish the next thing. But like, you just need to like, appreciate where you're at and try to take it all in. So whether it be last year's Olympia or whether it be at the Pittsburgh Pro guest posing, I just was having fun, man.
Yeah.
It's like we work so hard all year and we can do everything right and give our absolute best. And at the end of the day, you know, the outcome is not in our control.
Facts.
So I think the fact that we understand that, I mean, we're giving putting our best foot forward. Mm-hmm. we, you know, we're out there, you know, in our best conditioning and posing, you know, as hard as we can. But at the end of the day, like, we all know we're giving absolutely everything to this. So that's our moment to have fun and bring the energy to the crowd. So that's all I think about.
He's so diplomatic.
I know.
Bro, I thought about this before I came in here. I was like, I know Flex is going to tell me this, so I need to be politically correct. So. No, it's just how I feel, man.
No, I know. Listen, we done the podcast yesterday. He was very respectful. But I also had some good stuff out of Derek yesterday.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, no, there's a confidence to both of you guys. You know, listen, both of you had two different upbringings. Both of you had two different entry points into bodybuilding. You know, obviously, because it's fresh, you know, Derek basically was on stage, the Olympia stage, within 3 years of turning pro.
Oh, yeah.
And for me, I was 11 shows in before I turned pro. I was, you know, there was a lot of pro tan, a lot of chicken breast, a lot of athletes who I've competed against from, you know, all over the world. So Derek, truly, I would say, you know, not speaking on your behalf, but I feel like you kind of won. And then as the years have gone on, appreciated how fast you got it.
Yeah.
Because that's not something that really happens, especially to have, like, listen, you could go overseas right now and win a pro card. There's a lot of shows that have lesser competition. But in the United States, the competition is very tough. Yes, the ability to win your pro card now is not just an overall. You have to, in your class, in some cases, you know, second, if you're worthy enough. But you winning your pro card, winning the overall Mr. USA, a week later, winning the Tampa Pro, then he's fifth place at Olympia, standing against myself, having this conversation. Then a year later, there was this rivalry born between me and him. And he's in this mix of, hey, Flex, I'm so honored to be on stage with you. A year later, it's like,
fuck you.
Yeah. That's how it went.
Very close to that. Not an F you, but it was more like, you might be my idol, but now you're my rival and I'm taking you out.
Yeah.
You know, and I guess if that motivates you to want to work hard in the gym, but it was like all consuming for me. And I think just once I was able to stop focusing on other people, whether it be now Nick or Hottie or Samson or whoever, like I just focus on me now. And the outcome's going to be what it's going to be. And like I said, I'm going to give my absolute best to all these guys. And I think if we can elevate this together, if we, you know, if we do that. But, things happened incredibly fast. I think things happened really fast for Nick as well. And I don't know how he...
Somewhat, right, Nick?
Yeah.
It took me almost 10 years to turn pro, but once I did, then everything moved fast.
So you had that amateur loss, win, loss, you know, the cliche route to pro camp, but then you found your momentum, you got it. With Derek, he had this... straight shot to success, and then he's standing on the Olympia stage. By the way, his first Olympia experience was on stage, not even been to an expo or nothing.
No, I never even been to the Olympia ever.
Yeah, his Olympia expo was the stage.
That's awesome. Jay Emanian interviewed me after prejudging. He was like, or finals or something. He said, have you ever actually been to the Olympia? I said, nope, this is my first time, man. So I was thinking, how many shows have you done? Do you know?
Let's see. If I had to just... guess off the top of my head, I'd say around 15.
Okay. Yeah, I figured that's about the case because I was trying to do the math in my head. Flex, how many have you done?
Oh, my gosh. 20. I don't know. I've won 20-something pro shows.
Jeez.
Because I would do like 1-2 shows a year.
Okay.
Shit.
So. I did 2-3 shows the first couple of years I competed. But I believe this for me, I don't know how many years I've competed yet, but this will be my, I think, 14th. Show and 7th Olympia.
Can you find that out, Tyus? I don't want to be on my phone in the podcast. Can you look at Flex Lewis's competitive career?
Yeah, I'd like to know that.
Yeah, just to find out. I know you have to shoot off, and obviously I need to interview the big man, and we'll talk mad shit when he's gone, okay?
Oh, yeah. Well, I'll be watching this.
You won't.
I'll be watching this.
Yeah?
I'll be giving you guys a phone call.
You're
going
to watch this, buddy.
Oh! Oh, yeah.
Did you get that?
Watch this one.
Oh, yeah?
Okay, all right, I'm out.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, okay, all right.
What is that? That's a 3XL shirt right there.
Oh, my God.
It's a Triceratops.
Yeah.
Right there.
Triceradick.
They just found this under Mount Bisupius right there. You see that? All right, I'm out, guys.
Wait. In Patton. What do you want Nick to know that he's going to be expecting come the next Mr. Olympia?
Oh, bro, he knows what's coming. He knows I'm going to be, when I get home tonight, from here on, all the way to November, weekend of November, he knows I'm locked in, day in, day out, giving absolutely everything to bring my best. Last year was good. We had some hiccups. We did actually almost pull out 2 weeks out from the Olympia. Didn't happen, but this year.
Do you have any more travel or no?
This is it, man.
Good. He's shutting it down.
No, that's good. Good.
So, shutting it down, 16 weeks out, full go.
Tell him, Dad.
You can watch my YouTube.
Yeah,
you plug.
You can watch mine too.
No, appreciate you guys. Seriously, thank you so much.
Of course, absolutely, my bro. All right, bro. Watch them headphones.
Watch your step. Don't break nothing.
I gotta give this guy a.
I don't think I'll see you. I'll hit you up.
Always a pleasure.
Yeah,
pleasure.
Derek, it was great to have you here, my friend. Derek literally had some business in town, and he flew in and out. And of course, we've been trying to get him on the podcast, and it was Derek that said, "Let's lock this in." So
let's lock it in.
So, Tyus, you're gonna set yourself up, my man.
Love you.
Yeah, you go ahead. See you, Derek. Thank you, my man. I'll message you later. What's up, my man?
Hi.
We can talk shit now.
Fuck him.
No. I've actually had a good 2 days with Derek. You know, this is probably the first time that him and I have had dialogue without distraction.
Derek's awesome. I love Derek.
Yeah. You guys had some time together yesterday, too?
Yeah. So I was, Maria had to do some filming exercises at the torture gym, and he walked in. So we talked for a good, like, hour and a half.
Nice.
You know, and the thing with the Derek, you know, I just think overall he's a great person.
Yeah.
And I think that stands out because, you know, anyone can be a good bodybuilder, right? Mm. But when you're a great person too, with being a good bodybuilder, that completes it, right? You know, and when I was in Tampa, you know, for I don't know the 9-8 months I lived there, we bonded a lot. We did. We trained a few times together, but we mostly hung out outside the gym.
I never knew this. This is all new to me.
Yeah, I was at his house. You know, we were going out doing something. So, you know, Derek's a good person.
Yeah.
You know, and whether Olympia were competitive or not, he's someone that I will always call a friend.
Well, obviously, this is going to be kind of, I guess, the podcast will be out, our podcast before this one. We spoke about a few things, and that was the rivalry that we had back in the day. Because he came in after that straight shot to success, right? Mm-hmm. And I seen this kid with this incredible confidence, as he should. This is the Mr. Olympia. But then I was like, who is this guy to have such confidence coming into my fucking world?
Yeah.
You know, not that bad. But he had this and exuded this confidence. And he also had some people around him who were kind of like pushing the narrative. And I think in that mix of things, this rivalry was created really from external. It was people in between. And, you know, that's happened to you, too.
So I was just going to say, I think Derek went through what I was going through, which we let it consume us because, you know, and I'm sure he would agree if he was still here, we already had this, I guess, image of what we think people thought we were. And we already thought like we were the best. You know, we thought, so we had to continue to live up to it. So as cool as it is to think like that, it becomes very stressful in terms, you know, if, you know, I know for me, it's like, you know, like we talked about, I train at the same time every day. And it's like, once you get a routine, right, and everything goes well, one thing that fucks up, whether it could be a minute, and now you lose it. You're like, fuck.
Day's
like,
gone.
Yeah, exactly. Because we're so tunnel vision of this is who I am. This is what I got to do. This is what got me to where I am. I'm not going to let anybody fuck this up. Anyone who talks shit, they're going to get it. You know, you know what I mean? It just didn't matter. And I think now he has learned, as I'm starting to learn, it's like, yeah, who gives a shit?
Yeah. I've seen him change significantly. Yeah. And I've seen you change more than...
I still have, you know, those OCD things about me, obviously, but I have learned to chill out a lot more than normal.
you know, like I said, I still like to train at the same time every day. I still like to make sure I eat at the same time every day and all those things. But now if something, you know, oh, no, I'm a half hour, an hour late on a meal or something, like I'm not going to lose my shit. It's just because the reality now, it doesn't matter. What matters is if you're going to stress about it or not. That's what fucks you up.
That's exactly it.
You know, and I've learned. It was like last year when I would buy a house and all this, and it they get a little stressful, but I didn't let it bother me. I just said, it's whatever, blah, 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 and went on with the day. Mm. And there were times within those, 8 weeks that I may have not gotten a meal in, you know, for like 4 hours instead of two, but I didn't let it bother me, and progress was still being made. And I think, you know, as we all know as bodybuilders, stress is the biggest, you know, no-no within this. So even though you might not train at the same time as you would on this day, as long as you get it in, you're chilled, you're relaxed, it doesn't matter. The day is still good, you know?
Knowing this, what have you done? What effort have you done to make sure that you don't go down these old ways of getting stressed out?
I actually, you know, I'll keep bringing her up because she has helped a lot.
Please.
Maria.
As my wife has helped me too.
Was a big part because, you know, even when she came to visit me for like a month in Tampa, I didn't go out to eat. We didn't do anything. It was, this is what it was. Mm. There was no, let's go do this. It was, blah, 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 blah. And then, you know, actually when she came down, so before I actually came here to do the podcast, she was already coming back for like a week to just see me.
That's right, yeah.
And then I asked her if she wanted to extend her stay and come here. And she said, yeah, that's fine. The way I was able to just kind of stay calm, because, like I said, traveling is not my strong suit. So, you know, and it was funny because, you know, the flight that we got, I think it was at like 7 a.m. in the morning or something. So we had to be at the airport. So, like, and I'm like, fuck, how am I going to do my cardio? Like, what's going on? You know what I mean? So, but the funny thing is, I did not eat until I actually came to your gym that same day.
All day?
And did well, because there was a 3 hour, it goes back, right? Yeah. So by the time I landed and got here, it was like 9:30 or something.
Yeah.
So I'm like, it's, you know, this is late, but fuck it. So even though I've been up already for like six, seven, whatever, I did not eat a meal until I came here and did my cardio and left.
Is that because you wasn't able to do cardio, so you kind of punished yourself not to eat that first meal until you got here? What was that mentality?
I'm like, I'm still gonna do fasted cardio. And even though Matt was, you know, Matt or Maria probably were like, dude, you just eat.
Yeah,
like, you're gonna be fine. Yeah. I'm like, no.
Do you know what I've done before?
I'm going to get it in.
I've done that route, and I've truly done that route a few times. I've also gone to the airport a little bit earlier, and I've done my 30 minutes, 45 minutes of cardio in the airport, walking to from terminal to terminal.
That I've never done, but that sounds awesome.
And then you're on the plane, it's like, okay.
I did it.
I can eat my first
meal.
It's
just a mental thing. Yeah. And that's, you know, what I try to explain to Maria. Like, we have differences, like, especially with, like, condiments and things like that. I like everything plain.
Really?
I like to do it myself, okay. So I know exactly how much salt, what condiment. I don't. So, like, with MegaFit, I get everything plain.
Yeah.
All the chicken's plain, steak's plain, and I salt it up, and I do, so I know. She, on the other hand, don't give a fuck.
Flavor it.
Give me all that shit, right? So, but she sometimes gets annoyed with me, and she's like, I don't know why it matters so much. Like, who gives a shit? And I'm like, it's just a mental thing. Like, if it makes me happy, it's okay.
It's okay. You do you, I do
you.
You
know? And, you know, now she just knows. Yeah. Like, now if, like, you know, when she cooks me something, like, even with the rice, for the longest time, my rice, I do let no one cook my rice but me. And so I finally, am I talking too loud?
I was trying to say, for every listener, I was trying to signal to Nick to put his hand down because he's like, John Cena over here with his hand. You can't see me. Sorry, carry on, Nick. With my rice.
But now, I mean, even though I still make it, if she does it, I don't, you know, I'm like, okay. Cause I told her. She would be the one to, like, just kind of, and not measure the water. And I'm like, oh, my God, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm not eating that shit. And she'd be like, well, this is how I do it. You know, so, but now when she does it, she just does it the way I like.
And it's, you know, it's fine. And we that was like things we had to learn about
each other. Of course.
It's a relationship. What ticks us, what doesn't, what this and that. And like I said, it's been a trial. We've had, I'd say, a fast relationship to a degree, you know. Like, she's from Canada, so she kind of, we kind of just brought her here to a fast degree. And now, you know, we live together and things of that nature. So it's... Even though we've been together for over a year, we're still learning, and we're still progressing. So, it's been fun.
So, what advice would you give like, you know, somebody that is young, looking to look for a significant other that is, you know, going to support them in their fitness journey? Would you say that finding a girl who actually trains is somebody that would link with you better, or somebody that doesn't train? Because I've dated both.
What do you like better?
Well, the one that worked. That is no. She trained. So I guess for me, Ali won the Miss USA. She was focused. She was competing. She won a couple of pro shows. But then she retired.
I think...
But she understood the industry. That's what I meant.
That's the important part, is I think you need... For someone, especially at the level we're at... You need to find someone that's kind of went through it and knows.
And Maria has.
You know, Maria knows. She understands it. Not saying she enjoys it all the time, but she understands it. And she loves to train. She loves to work out. I don't want to say she's retired. I don't think she's retired yet. But she did take, you know, time off to let her body get back to her normal self, support me in my Olympia journey last year, you know, and also, you know, this year coming up. But I think it's very important to find someone that's kind of been through it, supports you, understands the situation.
I just gotta tell him. I can't do these figurative like hand gestures. I'm like, pull the mic, and he's like, "What are you saying to me, Flex? I can't hear the chords."
What'd you say?
Yeah, I'm like this.
And I think, you know, it's, and there has to just be a nice understanding and trust of each other.
Absolutely.
That's what I think.
Tyus.
Sir.
Are we on?
Yes, sir. What's up?
There he is. Last time we done the podcast, Nick, Tyus was faceless, if you remember.
I do.
Never had a video camera. Nobody knew who he was.
Now you're on.
And here he is. Hey, look, there he is. Look on the screen.
Look at you.
Yeah. Let's compare last episode with the episode with my face in it and see which one does better in the numbers.
Yeah. Tyus, do we have any fan questions for Nick?
Yes, we do.
Oh, shit.
Okay. Yeah, sorry if you weren't prepared for that. That's happening.
Now that's organic.
Yeah, of course. Okay, so how do you set goals for yourself? It's the first one.
Well, it's, I mean, I feel like I'm the wrong person to ask for that one, because when I decided to become, when I set the goal to become a pro bodybuilder, I didn't really have a goal I could say in mind. I just went for it. You know, I literally woke up one morning. I said, I'm going to prep for a show. And I did it. Was the worst prep of my entire life. It was horrible. It sucked. Hated every minute of it. But like I said, I enjoyed the thrill of being on stage. You know, I said it was the first time I actually felt, you know, accomplished. It was the first time I felt like people were proud of me. And I, ever since then, even my first show, weighed 159 pounds, fucking awful. I said, I'm going to become a professional. And I remember my mom looking at me and going, what are you talking about? What do you mean? And I said, I'm going to become a professional. And, you know, the next shows I did, I just got better and better. I started winning and winning. And she...
For those that don't know what's going on, or if you're listening to the audio version of this, Nick likes to cover his own face with his arm, and his arm is about 3 feet in diameter, so it covers everything.
I think we need to get him, you know how the Marines tie their fucking, their feet and their arms like this? I'm just going to put him down. Sorry, Nick. We're in such good momentum, and I'm trying to tell him without saying anything, I'm down.
I thought you were like, what time is this?
Oh, my God. And he just goes, what? Carry on, Nick.
Where was I?
I don't know. Oh, you done your first show. You enjoyed it. You felt the experience. Yeah.
And we're talking about setting goals.
Setting goals.
My mom just looked at me and was like, you did one show. What are you talking about?
And then the more I did it, mm-hmm. the better I got, the more winnings I got, the more, you know, she recognized it, the more supportive her and my dad became. And, you know, they saw the potential, you know. But one thing they always expressed to me was you always have to have a plan B. And I won't lie, every time my mother said this, I got really pissed off. You know, I love my mom, but I was like, fuck. You know, because it's like, I don't know. I'm all in. I'm gonna do this, and I'm going to be successful. And, you know, she's being a mom. You know what I mean? She's just looking, I'm her kid. She's looking out, making sure. You know, but eventually she just is like, you're going to do it, you know? And I guess the point I'm making is I said it and I did it, you know? And I think that's where goals are better at, rather than kind of having like a set plan or anything of that. Just do it. Just do it and see how far you can go. And if it doesn't work, it doesn't work, you know? Cause I even told, I don't know if I said this on last podcast, but I always told my mother when I did North Americans in 2020, I said, if I don't turn pro at this show, I'm done. I said, because I've been at this for 10 years. My mom and dad have been supporting it for 10 years. And I got to a point where it's like, I was 24, 25, whatever. I'm like, if nothing's going to happen here, I do have to learn to be a little realistic. Mm-hmm. And so, but I won. And then right from there, everything changed.
Not only did you say that in the last episode, but we used it as clickbait for the title.
You did. I remember that now.
Yeah, the clickbait title. Yeah. Everybody thought it was the Olympia. I had nothing to do with the thumbnails, by the way. So
that was clever.
Blame him.
That was clever.
But yeah, your mom actually, you know, talking about the Olympia, I had the pleasure of taking mom and dad around the gym.
Oh, they love you.
Yeah, I love them too. It was absolutely pandemonium, you can imagine. Yeah. The week of the Olympia, and your mom and dad popped up, and I'm like, what are they? My staff told me. I was like, what are they? And I was literally heading out. I was going somewhere, if I believe.
Yeah.
And they popped up, and I was like, I cannot not see these amazing people.
Yeah.
Give them a tour of the gym, and we FaceTimed you, I think, or called you or something.
Yeah.
Can you remember where you were?
Was I at my house?
No, you're at a fucking Cheesecake Factory. That's where you were. Didn't even get the fucking invite.
Yes, I was.
Cheesecake. That's right. I think your mum told me, this was a couple of days after the Olympia. I think your mum told me you had been to the Cheesecake Fight like 3 or 4 times.
Yeah.
Since it within like 2 days.
Me and Maria went almost every day. Yeah. Cause after the Olympia, I would do like one nasty meal for like a couple of days in a row. Mm. And it was Cheesecake Factory. Maria, I think she now hates that place more than anything in the world.
That's what sushi is for Ali at the time.
Yep.
Because my cheats were a couple of times a week in some cases.
I would go get sushi.
My body weight dropped so fast going into the 212 1 year that Neil would feed me up for sushi as my cheat for once a week. And then every 3 days, I was having sushi.
That's at one awesome. Point in.
So Ali was just like, you're on your own.
I'm not going this time.
I'm not, like, babe, I can't. And of course, listen, I'm eating sushi for me to hold my weight.
Yep.
In her eyes, the sushi were hitting the hips. So I was like, okay, I love these thick hips of yours. Don't worry, babe. Put that sushi in you. but the Cheesecake Factory, of course, like I said, was a place for me that I've done a lot of celebrating. So it's fun for me to now see you.
But I had to learn to venture my food a little bit. So we would go to like... Shake Shack a lot. She loves Shake Shack.
Yeah, I've seen you post about that place.
She loves Shake Shack. We go to Five Guys a couple times. We go to like a couple steakhouse, like Barry's.
Shout out to Barry's.
I love Barry's.
They
great place.
Incredible. Chef Barry and Yassim and Marco all a family at the gym.
And it's like even when it's just a nice experience. You know, like the way it looks, the way you sit, the way people come and take care of you, give you my favorite steak place.
Second to none. In my eyes, it's the best in Vegas. And I'm not just saying it because of our connections. The connections came way before they opened up Barry's.
They came because you like going there.
I go to Barry's so much so that my accountant is like, what the fuck is this Barry place? Who is Barry?
Who's Barry? Who is, why are you always at Barry's?
Is he a consultant? It's the best for all the viewers that are watching this. You guys see me posting this place. You see Nick posting. You've seen lots of different athletes here in town. Top athletes in different
sports.
It's the
place to go.
It's the it
really
spot.
Is.
Like last week, you seen who I was with. Fucking Mel Gibson.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, I was, you know, he's walking.
How is he? Is he nice?
Well, he was actually on one wheel, but he was like he was like wheeling past me, and he goes, "Yo, flex." Is that his accent? I don't know.
It's close.
No, he didn't say that. I was like, "Oh my God, Mel!" No, Chef Barry came over to introduce me to an NHL guy who played for the Golden Knights. He loves bodybuilding. He was sitting opposite. Hold on a minute. I should know his name. Tyus will have to edit this. No, but his chef body came over and said, "Hey, there's somebody that wants to meet you." And I was like, "Of course, I would love to meet him." It was Nick Haig. Haig plays for the Golden Knights. Excuse me, Nick. I do know who you are. Incredible player. And him and I came over. Him and I had a sidebar conversation, and literally, as we were having that conversation in the exact same spot, these guys kind of landed right behind us. He turns around, Mel Gibson looks at me, he goes, "You ain't small, man." And I'm like, "Oh my gosh, what happened to your leg?" That's the first thing I was like, "What happened to your leg?" I didn't even know he was, anyway, not even really funny, but we ended up having that photo, which has gone viral now. That was on Yahoo.
Yeah.
Yesterday, somebody sent me the link.
Really?
Yeah, it was on Yahoo. That's Yahoo News or whatever. So, Barry's is the place to be. It's got a wide variety of celebrities, and that's kind of where I celebrate
a
lot of wins.
I feel like that's where everyone just goes.
I've celebrated a lot of achievements there. That's my place.
It's great.
Yeah. So, what else is on the cheat meal rostrum for you? You said Barry's, Five Guys,
Shake Shack. You know, I'm not a huge In-N-Out fan.
No. Jay Cutler loves that place, huh?
I didn't really...
Yeah, no, me too.
Okay, as long as we're on the same page.
Yeah.
I didn't really vibe with it too much. I love Chick-fil-A.
Oh, yeah, I love Chick-fil-A.
I actually had Chick-fil-A last week. Matt gave me a little cheat sheet. But that's... I mean, yeah, we don't really go out. You know, I think we only went to Barry's because I know you could go there a lot. And I'm like,
don't blame me.
But I'm like, let's go to Barry's. Mm. So, I think we've been there like two or three times since we've been here. But we like fast food. We like, you know, we get dressed up every once in a while, but we like to just kind of go get a burger, go get dessert, and come back home and relax.
And we just celebrated the 4th of July together.
Yes, we did.
With a great group of people.
That was fun. That was a fun time.
I'm very happy to see you there with your Tupperware boxes full of mutant meals. But it was great to be around like-minded people who have a lot of you know, different people in that group that are very, very successful. And, you know, it's Vegas. What I love about Vegas is the ability to network.
Yes.
And you understand that now.
Yes. Like
in Florida, you kind of can find certain groups, but here...
It's not the same.
It's not the same.
Not even close, honestly. You know, that's what I said. When I got here, it just immediately connected. And I also knew the potential that could be here for me, as even well as for Maria, to do things for herself, you know? In Tampa, there wasn't like that, you know? So... That's why I figured being here, being surrounded by a lot of good people, and just building, you know, our own brands, I knew being here in Vegas, it could happen a lot quicker than, you know, if I was in Tampa.
And you're talking about building your brands. You know, we had a little sidebar conversation, and I'll just kind of open up this by saying Mark Wahlberg now. Moved to Las Vegas, and he's going to be creating a mini Hollywood Studios version of LA. Is that correct term? Tyus, what would it be? Yeah, like they're doing a Universal Studios, not the theme park.
I know you,
but in terms of shooting,
I know what you mean. Yeah,
and what was very interesting to hear when myself, you, and Derek were talking off camera was that you are truly interested. After bodybuilding, tail end of bodybuilding, about doing something else, maybe in that world.
Yes, I've always had an interest in acting. You know, when I was in high school, freshman, junior, I did like the whole drama club thing.
Did you?
I did, yeah. And my mother always told me I'd be a great actor because of how much of a pain in the ass I was.
Mom knows best.
She does. You know, but no, I just think I could be, like I said, when I put my mind to something, I think I could be really good at it. And I think I could be, you know, something good. You know, I think Derek asked me, like, what actor I would be. I don't know. I've never done it yet. But, you know, I feel like I could be a serious. I feel like I could be funny. Mm. I feel like I could be, you know, the action hero. I feel like I could be, you know, a serial killer if they wanted me to be. You know what I mean? Like, I just don't want to die first. You know?
Yeah.
I'm here to make a name. Don't kill me off right away.
You're the first guy to go.
I'm the biggest guy. And I killed this motherfucker.
Did you see Nick's part in that movie?
He got shot in the head or something.
He got shot. He's dead, yes. Damn, you were a good limp body.
You did great, man.
Limp. Limpest dead body I've ever seen. But no, that's very interesting, Nick, because listen, there's a lot of people who have attempted to do that, right, over the years, but we have the blueprint of Arnold, right? Arnold obviously came to this country, didn't speak much English, went through the, you know, the routes of bodybuilding and truly through his confidence alone, put himself into so many different circles.
Yeah.
Went on then to act, said, told the same thing, you're not going to be a bodybuilder, not going to be an actor, became the highest paid actor in Hollywood. Then decided to throw his hat into the politics. You're not going to be a politician. You're not from the United States. You don't know what you're talking about. You're an actor. Became the governor.
Then became the governor of California.
And to me, although Arnold is, for us, Arnold, what he's done and the autobiography that he truly has is really
insane.
Incredible. Incredible. And I think also it allows guys like ourselves who don't come from, you know, the silver spoon to look at somebody like that and be like, wow, that's incredible motivation. Whether we can relate to it in its entirety or not, just more so like looking at what he's done, and it gives you that confidence to be like, listen, he was a bodybuilder. I'm a bodybuilder. He didn't want to be cliched as the bodybuilder. That was a chapter in his life. I know because I'm going through that right now. You obviously right now are Mr. Olympia, but you're also thinking couple of steps.
Of course, you have
down the line. You have to, Nick. I'm very happy to hear this. So is this truly something that you're
going
to put yourself in?
I'm a bodybuilder, right? My goal is to win Mr. Olympia. But like, let's just say next year I get an offer of something, somebody. I'm going to go for it, you know? Because like I said, it's something I want to do. And if I can somehow, you know, juggle both, I will. But if I get an opportunity to, you know, act in something that, you know, is going to go viral or whatever, I'm going to take the opportunity, you know, and I'm going to flourish with it. And I think that's the beauty about, you know, the start of even me being the bodybuilder is it could lead to so many things down the road, you know?
If you was to pick any movie that you would say that you really kind of, I see myself being in that.
300. I want to be a Spartan warrior. I want to fuck shit up.
You just want to be half naked.
I actually had a plot if they were to make a third one, because have you seen it?
Of course.
So the first one, you know, Leonidas dies, and I was going to be in the third one. It could be like his son, all grown up, fucking shit up, getting ready to take Xerxes out, and I'd be the son. Phew.
I didn't know if they had enough food back in that day to fucking feed this monster. what would this look like?
That's why it's just a movie, bro. Okay,
I'm sorry. I'm it's 300, obviously, too. That's great. So you see yourself as more of that warrior type?
I could, but I also think, like, I would like to even be in, like, Fast and the Furious. I think that'd be fun.
Yeah.
You know, or be in, like, a comedy or something. Like, that could be fun.
I think a lot more bodybuilders really should start throwing the fishing pole out more to these things. There's so much opportunity. Like Kevin Leveroni, a number of years ago, he actually went into acting. He done a couple of things. I don't know, not sure why he never ended up truly throwing himself in it, but it was a couple of years where he done semi-decent movies from what I can remember going back, and he lost obviously a significant amount of weight to do them roles. But outside of that, there's really been not many bodybuilders. But what I do like right now, if you look at the landscape of who is some of the highest paid actors in the world. They're all in great shape.
Yeah. The Rock. The Rock.
Mentioned Mark Wahlberg.
Yep.
Who else have we got here? We've got, think of some guys who are in great shape. Tyus, who we got? Great, best shape actors.
Sylvester Stallone still
jacked. Sylvester Stallone, Jean-Claude Van Damme. They're the older guys, older regime. But that was an era where everyone was jacked. Yeah. Then everyone's skinny, and then they're coming back up. Like Chris Hemsworth. Jason Momoa, yeah. So you're throwing yourself now in a mix where people are looking and looking at these movies, and it's like, okay, that role goes to a bigger guy, you know? And there's definitely roles where you could fit. And, you know, being the size you are right now, they're making body suits for people.
I know, I don't need a body suit.
I know, you are the body suit.
I'm set and ready to go. Like,
he's ready. I'm just ready. Paint this fucking green.
Just
listen, obviously because Derek has been on, you had a kind of little segue this a little bit. So I was hoping to get into some deeper topics. I don't know if we'd be able to achieve that today because of the where we are right now in the energy of the room. But let's just take ourselves back to the podcast last year. You go through the Olympia. You said that was you were very happy with your place in. What transpired from then to now?
In terms of what?
In terms of the mentality shift. Obviously, the podcast came and went. The Olympia's come and gone. You went through that new year. Was it a kind of mentally kind of a new year, new me kind of thing? You've moved to Vegas. There's a lot of things that have gone on have changed. That's what my point is. So I truly also think, not to answer your question here, but I truly also think that you are now in a different chapter of life. I see this Nick that is just living life, fun, serious, but also I think that You truly like what you're doing more than ever. I don't know. I've heard things from certain people, and they've said, "Let's fuck it. Let me just pull the bandaid off." I've heard things from Matt. I've heard things from Maria. I've heard things from people that we're mutually friends with. That all seems like, this is the happiest I've seen Nick. This is the best version I've ever seen of Nick. And whatever's happened in Vegas, just make sure that Nick stays in this groove. So what has gone on?
To go back, I think, you know, especially with me and Matt, obviously, you know, that's one of the touchiest subjects for me, as I'm sure it is, you know, for him to a degree. You know, that was a very dark time. You know, and I don't know if it was a dark time for him, but I know, like, our split, I know it took quite a toll on him as it did for me. And, you know, he has played a major role, you know, in my life, even when we started, you know, prep back in, or got together back in like 2018. And it was, I remember when I messaged him to help me. And because I knew what kind of coach he was, you know, he had Dallas at the time, he had Ian, he had all these big names. And when he took me on, I felt like a rock star already. I was like, holy shit, this guy took me on, you know? And then we just bonded. We got close. We became really close. And when all that shit happened, man, it was, I don't want to, you know, it was like a heartbreak to it. It was like a breakup, you know, it was like, fuck. And, you know, I always knew at one point we would somehow get back together. Right. But that wasn't the motive. My motive, you know, was just to be friends again. You know, we weren't talking, and I knew it, you know, it fucked with him a little bit. It certainly did me, you know, so, but like I said, I think I said in the last podcast, the only way I knew how to amend that friendship was the way it started. And that was him coaching me. You know, that was the only way I knew how to do it, you know, and I expressed it to him, and, you know, and I think he saw how, you know, I changed. I was being better. I got out of my own head. And he, you know, he said, let's do it. You know, he's like, get right back to what we were. Let's leave it at that. We move forward. And, you know, people say that, but you always know it's still going to take, you know, a little bit of time. There's still like that little,
it's effort.
Yes. And I gave it everything. I know he gave it everything. Yeah. And I think that's the point in life, is you don't want to wear yourself thin, but you want to give your all to the people that mean most to you, you know, and what matters most. None of that extra bullshit, you know, not the social media, not the stressors, your girlfriend, your wife, you know, your coach, your family, your career. That's where your energy goes. You know, what the fuck are you eating, Flex?
Chewing gum. Tyus is going to kill me. Why did you call me a fucking asshole? The camera wasn't even on me. You just waited for me to slip up.
I did. I'm like, this man pulling some snacks out of his pockets.
Talk about a segue in fucking mood, yeah. I'm going to flash you now, my nuts. All right, carry on.
No, but, and I think that's what I had to realize. You know, I was too worried about everything else rather than what was in front of me. And once I got a grip on that, that's when I started to become happier. You know, I put my focus just on Maria. I put my focus just on bodybuilding. I put focus just on my family. I put focus just on, you know, me and Matt getting, you know, back and achieving what we started. And like I said, instead of all that other shit. And I think doing that has made me a happier and better person.
And since then, what are we, 6 months? 6 months past the Olympia? Maybe a little bit longer, but are we?
Yes, it was in December.
Yeah, so we're now in July. For anybody, whoever's watching this in the future, we're now in July. We're 16 weeks out to come this Friday.
Yes, sir.
An incredible starting point. In fact, if anything, mate, I've never seen you this lean, this far out, this big.
Yeah, and like I said, I like to take that to the training. You know, like I said, it's not something I haven't done before. I think it's just something I stepped away from, you know, because you get into prep, right? And what's the first thing most people think in prep? More. They think more. I got to do more. So, you know, they do more cardio or they start training more volume when they just don't need it. And then, you know, as you do, the more volume you get, less food, what happens? Most of the time you get weaker a little faster. So with this style, like I said, there's no intensifiers really, maybe like a little bit, but it's just straight sets. And the cool thing about it's you're just so focused on every rep, making it count, that you're not really taking any sets to the ultimate failure. You're pushing yourself. Yeah. Don't get me wrong, but you're not going to that failure point to where I believe it can become a little counterproductive. Because it's frequency, right? So you're pushing to improve every workout, but you're not pushing past, you know, to where you can't recover. And that was where I was telling you I had to learn that because I'm so used to
just beating yourself up.
I am. Yeah. And again, beating it becomes counterproductive. Yeah. And I think it's helped me, you know. You know, people in my last update, they've noticed my legs look, you know, bigger again.
Stephanie.
They've noticed I've other improvements. And I think it's because now I'm focusing on what I should have been doing, you know, when I was doing years ago, instead of, you know, thinking more is better.
Well, you're 29.
28. I'll be 29 in a month.
You're just helping my fucking, you're just helping my case here. You're 28 years old. You're, you know, third in the world.
Yeah.
And you have this incredible fan base, which you've already spoken about. You also have the pressure of delivering. But in and around that, I've said this also, that I feel like Nick now is slowly, but surely is, discovering who Nick is.
Yeah, I mean, I think, because I think, we talked earlier, it took me like 10 years to turn pro, right? But when I did, things happened like that. And I think within that, I did lose myself.
How so?
Because I was too focused on everything else instead of who I am. And I was focused on what people kind of wanted me to be, I guess, so to speak, that I wasn't me. And I think down the road, it began to take a toll on you, you know, and the unhappier I became. And then, you know, when I'd film YouTube videos, I would have to pretend to be happy and smile when I'm not. And that made it even worse, you know. And I had to take a long step back, and which I did. And I just realized, like, I am me. And if people love me, great. If people don't,
there's nothing I could do about it. You know what I mean?
Like, don't watch my YouTube.
Yeah, get unfucking subscribe for, like, you know what I mean? Like, shit. But that's, but I am, oh, I'm always honest. I'm always a real person. I hate lying. And I, you know, if I'm ever put in a situation, I feel horrible, whatever it is, but I will always be honest. You know, because I've learned over the years, when it comes to making hard decisions, at least 9 times out of 10, somebody's going to get hurt within the decision that you're making. But you, the decision maker, have to understand if you think it is what's best for you, your longevity, your life, your height, whatever, it's okay to feel bad, but don't go back on the decision because you're afraid that's this whoever, you know, is going to get hurt. It's part of life. It's part of making decisions. And, you know, you just have to accept what is, you know, and just welcome to the future of what you're trying to build.
Yeah, progression over regression, right? So your future plans are truly now starting to become everybody else around you's future plans for yourself too. Mm-hmm. Because you've made them aware of what you want to achieve, and because people now have seen the change that you've done to be a better person, that means that these guys who may have always been there, or they kind of may be new to the team, get closer to you. And they want the best version of you too. So even if you're having a bad day, they understand what that bad days look like. Instead of trying to fight you, and then because they give you a little bit of an attitude, then you give them an attitude. I understand this because maybe a little bit. I've got some experience.
A little bit.
But my people know that nobody wants them to do greater things than myself. You know, exactly. I want them to achieve greatness. I want them to make as much money as they can. Even just like before we went live, you know, Tyus was laughing because he's like, "You guys are podcasting before the podcast." We were talking about creating wealth.
Mm-hmm.
We were talking about what I see for your future. We were talking about contracts. We were talking about structure. And as I'm now kind of like the OG in the room, which is kind of weird to fucking say because I was always the youngest one.
I know.
I feel now my life experiences, I can pass back, pass forward, whatever the terminology is. And I just know I'm in a very unique situation now because I'm still significantly involved, but I'm also significantly away.
Away, yeah.
So I can go to yourself because I have no political ties. And yeah. Like, hey, Nick, I think you should do this. I think you should talk about this. Or I think you should reach out to this sponsor. Or this is, I think you guys should connect. And that's what we're talking about too. This gym has such a unique, day to day of people coming through that these improv connections, so these improv handshakes, they turn into so much. And now you as an athlete, before, and I'm just picking up on the words you've said, you are so kind of tunnel vision focused. I can't leave the house because this is going to be a detriment to my win. Now you're seeing the long game. You're seeing that, yes, you're still going to be disciplined. Yes, you're still going to have, you're not going to miss a beat. But putting yourself in and around circles that can create a future for you through, like I said, a handshake, through an introduction that's being purposely made, is now with the game that you're playing. Because not only do you see yourself as a Mr. Olympia, but you now see yourself as a business and a brand.
Yes.
And now you're talking about potentially doing things like acting. I'm not going to talk your business, but you've talked to me about other things too. And that's fucking life. It's aiming so fucking high that other people in this room, if they hear that, they'd be like, he wants to be an actor. And I'm fucking sure there's people watching this right now that'd be like, he ain't going to be an actor. Keep fucking telling him.
Everyone's doubted me my whole life, and I've done everything, you know, people said I couldn't do. I literally only have one accomplishment to go, and that's win the Olympia. You know, I always said when I turn pro, there's 3 shows I want to win. That was New York, the Arnold, and the Olympia. And I have one more to go, and I'm right there.
What do you see this year bringing to the stage than any other you have seen?
For me?
Yeah.
I really feel, you know, this will be the year. I feel I am going to bring a package that will surpass the Olympia package last year. What I envision is the condition that I had at the Arnold with the fullness that I had at the Olympia. Obviously with the improvements, you know, that I've made. And I feel with those, with that look, I personally feel I will win.
Tyus is like, I'm looking at Tyus because I was like, Tyus, you want to jump in? Yeah, and he was like, there's no questions you want to ask Tyus? You've had your opportunity all show. He now says he is going to win the Miss Olympia. I look at you when you were supposed to chime in and you just go, no, I'm just going to leave it right there.
Look. Okay, you talked about Arnold and how what he has done with his life and how amazing it is. And I remember when he was running for governor in California and people were like, well, he's not going to win. He's just, that's obviously a joke, right? And I said, there's no way he's not going to win. There's absolutely no way.
No chance.
Because he has won everything he has ever tried to do. And they've all been harder than running for office. I wouldn't put a bet against any of you guys, because one of the things that what you've done as far as physical discipline, you understand how to deal with pain. You understand how to put in the reps. I have no doubt that if you've set your mind to it and said, this is what I'm going to achieve, I'm sure you'll win. I'm sure you'll do it.
We had this conversation a few times, and I wouldn't want to hear anything but that. You shouldn't have anything but super confidence that you're going to win. Because, listen, the strain, the mental fortitude, the discipline, the sacrifice, et cetera, that goes into the Mr. Olympia prep.
Well, that's the point. We put our bodies through so much shit. Why am I going to say, I'll be happy if I get a fifth?
Yeah.
No.
Them days are gone, though.
I'm busting my ass, just like everyone else is, to win. Mm-hmm. I'm not here to get fifth. I'm not here to get top 10. I'm here to win. I don't kill myself every day doing 2 sessions of cardio, dieting, making sacrifices, all this shit to be like, if I get third, I'll be happy. No. If you have that mentality, you shouldn't be doing this. And that's how I feel.
Absolutely. In wrapping up this podcast, because Tyus just gave me the sign that we've been up to nearly 2 hours.
Hey.
I know. See, that's effortless when we talk.
We're going to need a part three.
Oh, my gosh. we are. But in going into this year's Olympia, looking at the landscape, looking at the athletes that were at the Pittsburgh Pro, looking at the athletes who are now prepping in different countries around the world, who is going to be one of your biggest rivals on that stage this year?
Derek and Samson. And I say Samson, obviously, because he beat me at the Arnold. And Derek, I think just because we match together very well, I think. And I just think, you know, obviously he's got, you know, the better shape than I do. But I'm improving my shape every show. And I do feel I outdo him muscle-wise. And my conditioning's always been top-notch. So if he slips at all, I will beat him.
I think that's the most beautiful thing about this class. And as I mentioned earlier, too, with both of you guys in the room, everybody is at that fucking level where somebody's off is somebody's advantage. You know, you guys are so... It's probably one of the most exciting Mr. Olympias I can remember in the last couple of years. Last year was an exciting Mr. Olympia. Obviously, it was in Vegas and everything else, and the nostalgia of being back in fight capital of the world, you know. And I'm so happy bodybuilding will be in Las Vegas next year, too.
Me too.
Our home.
Me too. Yeah.
But, you know, just to give the Mr. Olympia a shout-out, tickets are on sale, and they are going like hotcakes.
Sure.
So get your tickets in right now, because there is going to be a fucking showdown.
It is.
This year.
I have no doubt.
And as mentioned, probably one of the best Olympias that are such competitive in many a year. And any one of you guys could win that Olympia. Derek is uber confident. You were uber confident. Samson's coming off this whirlwind year that he's had to. Hardy is obviously coming from, you know, Iran, where that guy is, you know, putting in that work when nobody can see him. Obviously, I feel, even though Hardy is the champion, he's the guy that's kind of out of sight, out of mind. Until you get to see
him in person,
then you realize how much improvements he's truly made. Yeah. But the same thing goes to say about you too. You know, everybody sees what they see on the internet, but then when they get to see
you in person, it's different.
In person is different, and that's one of the most, as I said, exciting things this year. A very, very improved Nick Walker from last year.
Very
one that I have to again bring up this fact. Openly and honestly spoke on this podcast and was the podcast most viewed show in 2022. And to have you back on the show, mate, it's great. We have had conversation about doing some more things in the future, but we'll leave that for another time. But it's always great to see you in the gym, how you are with the fans. Always, again, listen, as I'm a fan guy, I've always prided myself in putting into my fans. I see you doing the same.
You have to.
From afar, you guys are always in the middle of your set. You stop, you take pictures. You know that you always have to be on, but that is a specialty tool that you have.
Yeah.
So if there's anything else that you want to end, promote, push, talk, I know you've got a couple of things that you're working on business-wise. Look down the camera and promote it. This is all about you.
No, man, I just want to say thank you again for you guys having me on. You know, I really do enjoy doing these, especially with you. You know, someone I still look up to.
Well, technically, look down a little bit, slightly.
And it's just, like I said, when we do these, it just goes well. I just feel like these are very, you know, organic. We don't really plan what to say. We kind of just go with the flow, and it's fun, you know? You know, shout out to all my sponsors that, you know, have supported me right now. We got HD, Mega Fit Meals, Gym Reapers, Celsius. You know, those guys are awesome. You know, and again, I'm just happy to be in the position I am. I'm happy to be maturing at a young age still and realizing what's going to benefit me, what's the better options for me. You know, and I'm happy that I'm starting to live in the moment a little more than I used to and not be so locked in, so to speak, and get to enjoy life a little more and realize that you can still be a champion at this and have a life. You know, people always said you can't have the balance, and I do believe that to a degree, but there's got to be some room, you know, to live life just a little bit, and I'm learning to create that, and I just think when you're able to have that, it'll make the success that much, you know, better. So,
well, my man, there's no better send off than that. And I think Tyus, you'd agree. It's always a pleasure to have you on the show. Looking forward to doing some more episodes, possibly closer to the Olympia. We can get into our mindset and what's improved from, you know, we're at that start of the off season to know whatever X out from the week. So, I'm always here for you. I'm always in my office, if you want to have these conversations, we won't put them on the mic, but and obviously text away, which I do enjoy our friendship. It's truly growing organically in friendship, and of course, you know, you've got so many people around you that over the years you've realized kind of who is there, and that trust is a massive thing. But as you know, I'm one of them guys that are here to support. I always want to see the best version of you, and you're proving everything and more to me on what I think of you. So
thank you.
Keep doing your thing. I'm looking forward to seeing the outcome of everything that's going in a couple of weeks, several weeks' time. Circling back is a must. So from myself, the Straight Out of the Lair podcast, and the mutant Nick Walker, Straight Out of the Lair, out.